This is episode number 215, featuring artist, author, and creative coach, Larry Moore.
This is the Plein Air Podcast with Eric Rhoads, publisher and founder of Plein Air Magazine. In the Plein Air Podcast, we cover the world of outdoor painting, called plein air. The French coined the term, which means open air or outdoors. The French pronounce it plein air. Others say plein air. No matter how you say it, there is a huge movement of artists around the world who are going outdoors to paint. And this show is about that movement. Now, here's your host, author, publisher, and painter, Eric Rhoads.
Thank you, Jim Kipping, and welcome to the Plein Air Podcast, everybody. I'm Eric Rhoads, and I am so glad to be back. As you know, I took a little hiatus due to some family issues, and man, I missed it. It's so nice to be able to be back doing interviews, being with you guys, hanging out. And I've been doing painting. I'll have to post some pictures. If you follow me on Instagram, it's Eric Rhoads, or Facebook, it's Eric Rhoads Publisher, or Twitter or otherwise, you can see some of the pictures that I will be posting. I bought a cute little electric wooden boat that is my new painting boat. I had one before that I was able to use, but I didn't own it. Now I own one. And I'm going to be having a name the boat contest, I'm sure, because I've got some ideas, but I need to get your ideas. And so keep an eye on that. Watch me on social media. Been out painting a little bit, but it's been really rainy here in the Adirondacks all summer. And so, I'd like to be painting more. I guess I just need to take the time and get out under an umbrella and do it. I've been getting a lot of questions about Russia, as you may or may not have heard. I'm taking a group of people to Russia to paint. We're going to be painting in the same places that Levitan and Shishkin and all those people painted, and also in the cities of Moscow and St. Petersburg, and some touring, because you got to do touring when you're there, and you got to do the museums, and we're doing a private showing inside the Hermitage Museum. And the event has been sold out. I'm limited to 50 people, and it's been sold out. But the gift of COVID is there are a couple people who are on the fence about going or not able to go or can't because of their health concerns. And as a result, I have a couple seats left. And if you want to get one of those seats, go ahead and check it out at paintrussia.com. Now, happening this week, in case you haven't heard somehow, is Pastel Live, which is our online virtual event for Pastel. It's the largest virtual Pastel conference in the world, and we have instructors from all over the world. And even if you don't consider yourself a Pastel artist, which I don't, it's an opportunity for you to get out of your box and learn something new, and I'm very excited about it. We're diving into 3 days of back-to-back workshops with some of the absolute best pastel painters in the world, and we also have a beginner's day, which is a fourth day, actually the first day. You can, if you want to learn all the basics of pastel, you can just do that alone. Anyway, check it out. It's called Pastel Live, and you can find it at pastellive.com. If you want to come paint and hang out with me in the next in-person event, it's going to be Fall Color Week, the Publisher's Invitational. And there's no invitation required. I don't know why I call it that. It started out by invitation. Anyway, this one, Fall Color Week, is going to be in the Adirondacks. The color here is spectacular. I learned that last fall because my kids went off to college and I stayed here in the fall for the first time in 30 years. And so it's so spectacular that I decided to get a place, and we have a one-time opportunity to stay in this great camp. It's actually a kids' camp, and because of COVID, we had a week available, but it's the only time we're ever going to be to go there. And when I took our group there for one day of painting, and they were drooling about the place, they wanted to stay there for a week. And so if you want to come back and paint with us September 30th through October 7th, just go to fallcolorweek.com, learn more about it. And there's no pressure. Everybody is painting their own thing at their own level, and there's no workshops, but we all kind of help each other out. Some people come just to kind of learn the whole plein air thing. So if you want to come, it's going to be fun. If you haven't yet checked it out, you should check out our featured art video workshops, Painting with Energy, featuring Bill Davidson, who's conducted 150 workshops and has really figured out his teaching thing. Anyway, Bill's video has a 5-star rating and people love it. You can find it at streamlineartvideo.com or actually just go to streamlineart.com and you find Bill Davidson there. In the current issue of Plein Air Magazine, it's our 10th anniversary all year, by the way, and we are going to learn how to make nostalgic scenes even more compelling with an article on Stephen Walker, who relies on simplification and depiction of fleeting light effects to create his scenes. And it sounds pretty incredible, and I think you're going to find it really incredible. Also, if you've not checked out our free weekly newsletter, Plein Air Today, it's a great way to stay connected with Plein Air groups across the country and the world. And there's something new we're about to announce, and you got to be a part of it to understand what we're going to do. So just go to outdoorpainter.com and sign up for Plein Air Today. And anyway, that'll be terrific. Coming up after the interview, I'll be answering art marketing questions in the Marketing Minute. You're going to love this interview. Let's get right to it with Larry Moore. Larry Moore, it's about time. Welcome to the Plein Air Podcast.
I've been waiting for you, my brother.
I've been waiting for you, baby. Well, the backstory on this is we've been trying over and over and over to get this recording done, and you know it seems like one thing and another got in the way. So here we are, finally.
Yes, I've been waiting by the phone. I'm like, why hasn't he called me?
Yeah, don't call us. We'll call you, right?
Yeah, all good. Not like I'm not busy.
Yeah, tell us what you're busy doing.
Oh, Lord. I'm a little scattered in that I have all these things that I want to achieve and accomplish. So I'm working on three different, completely different lines of paintings. Of course, I'm teaching now that things have opened up again. Hopefully that'll remain. I've been teaching around the country what I teach, which is principles of abstraction in painting. And then I started writing another book, more of kind of an addendum to the last book, Fishing for Elephants. And plus, I'm just trying to do Zoom classes and, you know, just a lot of different things at once and sleep. So, and I like sleep.
Well, you're just a glutton for punishment.
As we both know, our time on this planet is short and there's much that I need to do and there's a lot that I need to say to people. And I think that should be helpful to them. And that's my purpose in life, I think. And speaking to you, as I have several times, and at the Plein Air events and, you know, all the your convention, those are very important things for me. So,
well, it's very important to us too. So thank you for that. So, let's just go ahead and start talking about abstraction. We don't need to hear the history stuff. I mean, we might get into it later, I think it's interesting for me to see what we go through as we become painters. I can't speak for a lot of other people, but I do see a lot of similarities to what I went through as a painter. And that is, I kind of started out with this this belief that I wanted to do photorealism, although I didn't know it was called photorealism, but it was kind of like, make it look like the photo, make it look as detailed and tight as possible. And I kind of went through that for a long, long period of time till finally I started letting go of that. And I think this idea, this concept of abstraction is something that really needs to be focused on and talked about. And again, I don't think there's a right or wrong. Everybody should do what they want to do. But talk to us about abstraction.
Yeah. And to be clear, when I teach these things, I'm secretly teaching two things, which is, how to find your own voice, whatever that is. And I think a lot of people don't quite know what that is because they spend a lot of time learning the mechanics of painting. And the other thing is I'm teaching design, you know, the principles of design. Some of this stuff emanates out of my, I've had a very diverse background in graphic design as an art director in advertising. You know about advertising. And as an illustrator, and a lot of that involved conceptual concerns and coming up with a voice for the artist. So what I teach isn't so much how to be an abstract painter, although that certainly can happen. It's just a different way of approaching how you think about what you're trying to go after. And so my premise is, and I've kind of just developed this whole thing on my own, but it works like a charm. So I know it's solid, and I've been teaching for 30 years. But my premise is to through a series of exercises, get artists to compose space using the components of what we use to make any painting, which are the components of the painting, which are line, mark making, value, edge, shape, you know, color choices, etc. And to learn to train, this is very much like training anything, training in music or weight training or in martial arts, any of those things, is we're practicing the rudiments so that we can become better at whatever it is we choose to do. So a big chunk of this is changing or enhancing the way we think about painting. I never actually argue it, but my
Well, let's
my
argue about it.
All right, let's
go. What do you mean?
My main thing is that all forms of painting, from hyperrealism down the chain, are a level of abstraction already. I don't care how hyperreal you get, there's still a level of abstraction. You can't possibly get every molecule of information from whatever your source is. Plus, you're converting three-dimensional space into two dimensions. And if we move to down the spectrum from hyperrealism and into levels of abstraction, we start playing with things like shape or edge or color or how to break an edge, how to use pattern, how to use paint in an inventive way. These are all levels of abstraction. So in order to get people into the mindset who are realist painters, I say, just look, here's a series of paintings, one becoming slightly more interpretive or stylized, if you will, until we reach the stage of non-objective, which is there's nothing in the painting except for the marks and the colors. And to me, the difference between the two in realism, the components of painting, the marks and the colors and the shapes, are in service to the content, like landscape or figure. But in non-objective or abstract painting, those things are the content. And when you can learn to compose space, to take a canvas and make it work, to move the eye, the ultimate goal being two things. One is to move the eye, what we would call composition, that I call hierarchy or eye flow. And the second is to express to express an emotion or a feeling or a sentiment or a thought or an idea. You can apply these things back into, as most people end up doing, into their representational work or figurative work, and become stronger and more what I refer to as authentic in their efforts. So I don't teach what I teach to change anyone's mind. It's really to make them think and become more who they really want to be.
All right. I want to rewind here for just a second, because
If
I'm new to painting, I'm a lot of things are going through my head.
Yeah.
When I took photography courses from Fred Picker, who was a student of Ansel Adams years and years ago, I took a 2-week workshop and I complained to him. I said, you know, we're not out there doing photographs and photographing cool things. We're focusing only on technology. And he said, yes, exactly right. He said, until you can get to the point where technology is second nature, in other words, you know how to set the light, how to set the composition, how to, you know, get the focus and, you know, the out of focus and everything. Until you get those things down, you cannot be free to be creative. Would you say the same thing is absolutely true? Learning
absolutely.
The technology of painting before you start going into these other areas?
Yes, of course. And I sort of break it apart as the mechanics of painting, which is the craft of painting, which, as you and I both well know, it takes a lifetime to get to improve on. And I don't use the word perfect because we never quite do that. So we have the mechanical side of painting, And the artists that we know and love, Sargent and, you know, you name them, Soroya, are masters at the mechanics of painting. And in addition to, they're masters of composition, of content, of communicating an idea. And they're two very different things. But yeah, it's just like music. You can't sit down and play piano and play Chopin or even compose your own stuff until you know where the notes are and you've spent your 10, 20 years practicing the rudiments. And that is true for painting and music and architecture and writing. It's across the board.
So these concepts, if somebody's a relatively new painter, is it a little too soon to be dipping into them, or is it better for them to learn them early?
Well, I can't speak to that exactly. I will say it's easier for there that you mentioned this term right off the bat, letting go. And that's a primary sort of feature in this process of exploration. I call it discovery, but it's exploration, which is the idea of letting go in order to find something that is of interest to you, that sparks for you. And they're different for every person. So, if you're a flat beginner, the first thing you need to worry about is the rudiments, the very basic things of surface and how to mix and what brushes can do and viscosities of paint and how to move paint around. And those are super important things. And then as a realist painter, you have to learn drawing and value and edge. And all of these components apply also to abstract painting with a little more freedom, with a lot more freedom. And I'll just say this real quick. The difference between representation and abstract is, other than what I just said, in realism, there's a model that you're trying to pattern your work after. It could be a figure, it could be a vase of flowers, it could be a landscape. So you have a model, but in abstract, you are the model. So all of this stuff emanates out of you. And, but at first, going to what you just said, you really have to understand the mechanics. Make no mistake about that. I can take rank beginners and give them, I have had a couple of beginners in my classes who've never touched a brush before end up doing pretty remarkable things in 4 days. But that doesn't mean that they can go off and become competent abstract painters. I guide them through the process without giving them ideas or directing them on how to do things. But the understanding the rudiments is a universal truth. That's for sure.
I think one of the most important things I ever learned when I first started painting is my instructor came up to me and he said, "It's all wrong." And he scraped down my painting.
Yeah.
And I was pretty frustrated, and I watched other people freak out and completely leave after that experience. But yeah. His point was you got to do it right, whatever right means in your particular case. Now, he was trying to teach us drawing and teach us painting in a certain particular way. And and I think we get to the point where, you know, a painting becomes so precious to us. You know, we do something, we find a passage in our painting that we've done really, really well, and we don't want to let go of it, even though that passage may be screwing up the whole rest of the painting. So I think learning to just be willing to screw it up and let go from the beginning, I think, is an important lesson.
Yeah, it's a tightrope that you have to walk between control and letting go. And in realism, you and I both know there's a high element of control that we have to maintain in order for things to read three-dimensionally in a two-dimensional space. And so that requires a lot of training and a lot of understanding of form and value and color relationships. And I taught realism for years. You know, I taught plein air for many years. So I know how those lessons are important.
The other part of that is, I think there's a method to teaching and there's a method to learning. Let's first start talk about the method to learning. Method to learning. Yeah. So if I'm a brand new itty bitty painter and I, you yeah. know, I, I'm going to attack this. What do I need to have in my head? What is kind of the process I need to be expecting, and what kinds of things should I be doing?
Good. So let's start at the very beginning, which is there's two facets of this, these decision processes. To be an artist is an act of 10,000 decisions. And the very first basic decision is, what kind of artist am I going to be? You know, that's number one. Am I going to be a painter, or am I going to work in clay? Do I want to be an architect? So you say, well, okay, I think I want to learn painting. Well, what kind of painting? I guess realism, you know, let's go with that one. Okay. What kind of realist? Well, if I want to do hyper-realism, then, so what we're doing is we're just establishing a motive. And that is, what do I want? What do I want to achieve? And what do I want to receive from what I'm doing? And what do I want other people to receive? And so these are the first rounds of decisions that we have to make, with an understanding that the path can shift. And that's a big thing to bear in mind, that you may get halfway through, as many artists do historically. If you look at art history, they start off in one path and then they veer off and ultimately go their own way. So in the realm of, say, realism, of representational painting, we have to decide, well, who kind of, for now, who do we want to be? What, and that's why we take workshops. We model our idea of who we want to be based on what we like. I contend that we go through that process, the apprentice master process, which is now readily available thanks to, you know, to you and Plein Air Magazine and Streamline, and other schools. But at some point we have to make decisions about what are we going to do with this stuff. And you need to train like you're going to the Olympics. So that requires just time, you know, brush miles, time on the canvas, drawing, understanding of color value. And my recommendation is always break them apart. Practice drawing for 6 months, practice mixing color and color relationships for 6 months, or, you know, longer. Practice value studies, as this is a very common idea. But what you do is, and what I always say is, realistically, or any kind of painting, is you're juggling 10 balls. Because you have all these different things I've just mentioned that you're trying to apply at once. It's really quicker to learn them one by one and then put them together. So that's a great sort of ground plan, foundational ground plan, to spend 2 or 3 years just studying the basics. We all want to create the paintings and get them up on Facebook, or get them into the galleries. And that can happen, you know, certainly, and it does happen. But the world is full of people who maybe went out there a little too soon, you know. And if your motive is to be the best painter you can be, then you just have to put in the time without expectation of practice. And we kind of live in this world of instant gratification. So that's a hard thing to get your brain into.
Yeah, well, in a Facebook, Instagram world, it's, hey, look at me.
Yeah, yes, of course. Yeah.
And that can be damaging to one's brand, actually. So, one thing that I see happening a lot is that early stage students get frustrated and quit. They come into this with this belief, and because we do all the teaching and so on that you referred to, we run into this all the time. It is, I don't have any talent. I can't draw a stick figure. They think that Sargent or Saroya or Monet or whomever sat down one day and all of a sudden they were just a master. You know, they were great at this. They don't think about the fact that, you know, you want to learn the piano, you go through that process. You want to learn brain surgery, you go through, you know, 30 years of school.
Right.
And so how do you keep people from getting frustrated early?
Well, this is one of the things in the list of things that I sent that we could discuss. was the secret to happiness. And the secret to the happiness is to have goals, but to let go of expectations, you know, because things always take longer than we hope. And the, my phrase that I use, my tagline is, if you put all of your joy into the process of doing, but and not into the outcome, you'll never be disappointed, because you're always going to be joyfully doing what you're doing. And even the mistakes are like, okay, this is just part of the process. It's part of growing up, as it were, as an artist, as a person, and evolving. And I've met people who are so joyful in the process. And some of them were just flat out beginners. And that is such a huge place that you have to kind of make yourself be in. Otherwise, you're going to be miserable. And I know really talented people who make themselves miserable because they can never attain this thing, which is unattainable anyway.
Who are they? I want names.
No names. But, you know, we all do this to ourselves, yeah. You know. And another thing I would say to the beginners who look at the who we consider to be the masters of this time, and I suspect it's true for all the great masters, is none of them were ever happy with what they did. You know, at some point they have to, you know, it's their best effort and the best they can do, and they're satisfied at that time with what they've done, and then the painting moves on to inspire the galleries, the museums, whatever. But I guarantee you, none of them were ever completely happy, because that's the thing, I call it the ugly muse, that drives us forward, you know, to be disappointed or not, to know that you're not where you want to be, you know, and you can face it however you want. You can face the disappointment, or I failed, or I'm never going to be good, or you can face it in a more positive light, which is, I'll get better. And here's my analogy. I take martial arts, and I'm terrible at it. I'm just awful at it, and I've been doing it for 4 or 5 years. And I'll occasionally utter the words to most people call him sensei, but to the master at the dojo. And I'll just say, I'm terrible at this. And he'll say, no, you're going to be better at it next time. You know, so he's just reframing what I'm saying in a more positive light. So the best thing anybody can do is encourage themselves to just enjoy the process. And take the expectations out of why can't I paint like Sargent? You know, newsflash, none of us can paint like Sargent. There's a handful in the world who maybe can touch him, who are living today. But even still, the guy was just, you know, the Mozart of painting, you know. So there are people in the world that we can't match their skill set. And to be happy with where you are and know that you'll improve. And that's a state of mind. I mean, one of the biggest things I talk about in the very beginning of the abstract classes is I call it the 80-20 rule. 80% of what we do in this process involves psychology, the psychology of painting, and the intellectual properties of the decision-making process. And you have to learn to master those two things. The 20% is the mechanics of what we do, which ironically, the 20% takes a lifetime to master. The 80%, you can conquer that in a moment. It's a simple decision, a switch, a flip of the switch, if you will, of making a handful of decisions to enjoy the process and not the outcome, you know. Put all the energy into the joy of study. And so these, you know, the 90% or 80% of this is like, is how you frame what you're doing. And I've met joyful people, and they are so much fun to work with. And I've met people who are anxiety ridden about their work. I'm like, you're just making yourself miserable. Where's the joy? Where's the fun in that? You know, is this how you're going to spend your time? And life's short, you know, so. I went through that moment, and I just, in a flash, I just said, I'm not going to be miserable about this anymore. I'm just going to know I can be better, and leave it at that.
Yeah, I mean, you're playing, you're having fun, you're doing something that is creative, and maybe you're not getting where you want to be, but I was up at my Fall Color Week retreat in Canada one year, and I offered some, I teach marketing for artists, and I offered some marketing counseling. I said, anybody wants some time? So a few people booked some time, and two people in a row, they're like, well, how do I sell my paintings? How do I get into galleries? How do I do this? And I said, do you need to do that? And two of them said, no, we don't need to do it at all. And these were separate sessions. And I said, well, why do you want to do that? And they said, well, I just thought it's what the next level of progression was. It's what I'm supposed to do. And I said, there's no supposed to. And if you just let go of that, it puts you under tremendous pressure because you're like, oh, I got to get into a gallery. I got to get good. And, just paint for yourself, paint because you want to do it. If you want to get your work out there, you want the recognition, donate them to somebody or, give them away or, do something, but it doesn't have to be about selling something. But I think that this is part of what happens with social media. It's like, I'm traveling here. How come that person's doing all this? I'm not doing that. They're doing great paintings. I'm not doing that. I think we really have to manage the mindset of what we're putting into our heads.
Absolutely. And speaking of the psychology of, and what you just said specifically, there's two components that are the great inhibitors. And one is fear. And that's the fear of making a mistake. And you have to make mistakes. That's how we learn. And the other is assumptions. And we build our idea of the world on a set of assumptions that aren't necessarily true. If you join a school of thought like a neoclassical classicism or some colorist modality thinking where they preach, oh, this is how it's done. This is the way. It's a little like religions, is it the way? There's a lot of different ways out there. And so one thing that I would always have people do, and I preach about this every day in my classes, is to check your assumptions and make sure they're correct, because the upside of social media is it's a great pool of information. The downside is we look at what people are doing and we assume, well, they must be successful, so maybe that's what I should be doing. And what they're doing is they're sending themselves down the wrong path that they will eventually have to correct in some way. It will happen. And so a little upfront consideration about what they should be doing. I have this whole thing about schools of, and I mean schools of let's just say Hope School or the Hudson River School, as an example. It's a line of thought, but it's not the end all be all. And I know this because I go into museums and I see all kinds of lines of thought. So there isn't one. There's no singular line of thought to follow. And we just pick them for any number of reasons. And I've always studied artists, and their progression. It's great to see a retrospective book on any artist, because you can see them grow and they start in a place that's not unlike someone in their circle or that they train under, that again, the apprentice master. And you can see how they ultimately go, yeah, that's not me. And they start wandering off down their own path. I always recommend, do you watch any Netflix?
Well, of course.
Okay. So do you know the, what is it? Chef's Table.
Yeah.
Have you watched any of that?
Yeah.
It's a great series. And I'm not even a foodie, but it's beautifully shot, beautifully edited. And it's each episode's a story about a chef who ultimately, all of these stories are about the artist finding their voice. And it's the realization that all of them grow up in the French school. And at some point in their lives, they go, that's not me. I'm Brazilian. I'm going to be the best Brazilian chef I can be. And I'm going to take all the stuff that I learned from the master and I'm going to apply it to the thing that is really who I am.
But there's a time and a place. So if let's say that a young student who wants to paint like Jacob Collins or Daniel Graves, and so they sign up for one of their schools and
do that.
And fantastic. And you get into a Jacob Collins class, at least this is my perception of this, it may not be real. And Jacob is like, no photographs.
Yes.
You know, but it's right. because he wants people to learn to draw, and drawing is the foundation of everything. And
right.
and then
right.
you know, and then it's the layering and the, you know, the way things are done. But,
yes,
you know, sometimes you've got to kind of stick with the knitting of where you're learning. And then, you know, once you, it kind of goes back to those foundational principles, right? So you get, you get those foundations. And then, you know, once you leave the Florence Academy, then you're like, okay, now I've got my own voice. And I've seen people who stick with that, you know, that very, very tight, dark, realistic style. And then you have others who are, you know, they're blowing through it. They're coming up with, you know, Adrian Stein, for instance. What a terrific example of someone who is classically trained, but now is really out there and doing some very interesting and exciting things.
Oh yeah, there's a whole bunch of realist painters who are trained along those lines, who are breaking away. And I do want to reinforce what you're saying. You got to start somewhere, and you really want to learn best practices and best principles. But ultimately you want to listen to, and this, if, you know, with the stories about the chef's table, they all went through the French school. And I mean, they put in their 10, 15, 20 years learning the art of cooking, that is the mechanics of cooking, before they got to the place of like, that's not who I am. So you do have to go through that process.
Well, and don't you think you have to study under a master to become a master ultimately?
I think within the framework of, say, traditional painting, absolutely. There are a few cases, not many, but of artists who have just said, you know what, I'm going to figure this whole thing out on my own. Contemporary artists, more specifically, but like Ava Hess or just a handful of artists who just said, I don't think there's anyone who can teach me what I need to know. But if you're in the framework of representational painting, absolutely, to become a master, you should learn from a master. And it'll shorten the period of time.
Yeah, there's a little bit of chest beating and pride that goes with being self-taught. And yet I look at that and I say, if I were self-taught today, I'd be 30 years behind where I am, because spending time with someone like yourself or someone like a Joe McGurl or Jacob Collins or, you know, whomever, I mean, they're just going to elevate, you're going to learn things that they've spent 40 years learning, and you're going to learn them in 3 or 4 years. So it's going to speed up your process. I don't think there's a right or wrong, but I do think that we can help ourselves by getting out there and learning from somebody else who's been through these wars.
Yeah. And every bit of that comes down to the individual. You know, like you said, to back you up on this, there's no right or wrong. It does help to train under a master who can give you all the hand you down as was handed to them, these traditional elements of creating. But I can at the same time show you or point to countless artists who arrived at their own voice on their own the hard way.
and it's really beautiful when you see that happen too.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. There are rules, but again, there are no rules, and it comes down to the individual of what's important to them. And that's a long, slow process. Some people actually know that early on, but most don't. And we come to it in our time.
So how do we find our voice? I get that probably is the biggest question anybody ever asks. How do I find my voice? And there's this debate, does the voice come to you, or does it just kind of come out of you, kind of like your handwriting, it's your signature? It's just, you know, when you're a kid, you practice copying your mom or your dad's signature, and you're coming up with your own over and again. And then sooner or later, it's just all of a sudden, it's your voice. What do you think?
I think for most, it's a long, slow burn, but I break it down into three different parts of developing a language to speak in. And I'll get to that more specifically in a minute, but developing what you want to say, the concepts or the content or the narrative in your work. And this applies to everything. This applies to music. It applies to architecture and fashion design. And then the methodology. There's those three columns. And the methodology is the mechanics of. And if you're a painter, that will be, the materials specifically. The language portion of the event, which is what I teach in my classes. There are 4 and 5 day classes, and I'm cramming basically 2 years of information into 4 or 5 days. But we start with just developing a language that works for you in the abstract realm, which you can apply. Once you find a language that you're comfortable with, you can apply that to realism, or just stay with it in an abstract mode. But so the voice is comprised of three huge things that take a lot of time, a lot of consideration. And the language of abstraction, the language of painting, really. Let's talk about, let's give it a framework that we can sort of all agree on, which is the landscape, right? So we can look at any, a handful or 100, I'll just say, of known landscape painters, like George O'Keefe and any of the Taos painters, you name them, Gustav Klimt, Sargent, Sorolla, as I mentioned before, and we can look at their work and go, oh, that's a Klimt, just right off the bat. Even if he's painting trees and lakes and stuff, or there's a George O'Keefe, even if she's painting trees and lakes, you know the difference between the two. And the reason is because they have their own unique language of how they handle shapes, how they handle colors and form gradations and mark making. We know a Matisse when we see it, even if he's painting the figure or an interior of a room, because we know his language. And so that's where we start in a class setting, is figuring out what language works. Is it mark driven? Is it more about color, or is it a combination of the two? I could cite a contemporary artist now, but I don't know that the listeners know who all these people are. So, everybody has a signature in their work of these components of line, color, shape. And so that's the first step and stage of the voice of the artist. And then we get into, what we're applying the language to, which is, am I going to paint the figure? Am I going to paint a landscape? Am I not going to paint any of that at all? Am I going to put birds in abstract? Is what I'm doing right now. What's my content? What's my message? And these are more intellectual concerns. And then the fourth is, how do I make that happen? What paint do I use? What best suits the language and the content? Am I an oil painter? Am I a watercolorist? Am I using gouache? All these different things. So I've spent, the last 8 years, 10 years, once I started writing this book, figuring out on my own, like, what makes one person different from the next? And how do we identify that? And how do we break that down into these learnable chunks? And so the voice of the artist, there are exceptions to every rule. And for every hard rule, say in painting, when someone says, well, you should never blah, 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 I can show you someone who is hanging in all the museums around the world, who does exactly that thing you're not supposed to do.
Never put something in the dead center of the painting. And yeah, you see people who do it all the time who just completely blow you away.
Yes, of course. And it also just goes to a kind of certainty in the work that defies the rules. It's a long, slow process of discovery for most of us. But again, there are some people who just come by it naturally and they know.
One of the things that made a huge difference and breakthroughs for me is that I started, it was because we were doing these virtual events to survive, right, because of COVID.
Yes.
So we did we did watercolor live, and I didn't do a lot of watercolor, and I attended it, and all of a sudden my oil painting got better because of the watercolor techniques that I was learning. And now I'm learning pastel because of pastel live, and all of a sudden I'm seeing ways to approach things in my oil or my watercolor. So I think the idea of getting out there and stretching your brain and trying other things, it maybe not too soon, because you know you're trying, if in the beginning stages you're just trying to figure out how to manipulate a brush or a color, but or mix a color, but eventually I think those things really help pull you out and maybe also take some of the boredom away and make it more fun again.
I couldn't agree more with you on that one, Eric. And I have a distinct advantage in my career as an illustrator, because this is pre-digital, you know, mind you, and I worked in pastel, oil, acrylic, airbrush, even for all of those for 25, 30 years and concurrently, you know, or simultaneously, I should say. And so I wasn't taught by anyone. I just figured it out on my own. I majored in graphic design, and I was like, well, what's this medium do? And what's that medium do? And which one best suits my purpose? And sometimes a job would come along and pastel wouldn't quite work, so I'd switch over to acrylic or gouache, which I've used a lot. And in my classes, I make everybody start in gouache. And everyone says, well, I've never worked in gouache. I'm like, exactly. Because the first thing we have to do is learn, it's a boot camp, and we have to reset. And I have to take you out of what you're already knowing, anything that you already know, or start from scratch. And so you're going to learn that there's discoveries that you can make just by switching over to a different medium. And which I've done all my life. It's second nature to me. And I just consider, you know, what does this medium do? What does it not do? People don't like acrylics because it dries fast. I like acrylics because they dry fast. You know, it's that sort of an idea. Gouache to me is like having a horse that has a wild horse, you know, it doesn't do whatever you want it to do, but what it does is beautiful anyway. So, the switch up is great for you. It's, if you're a guitarist, go play a piano for a while and you'll learn something new. We do get caught up in just hammering on the one thing. And I've seen this also, artists who late or mid career just switch mediums. Scott Christensen's a great example. He's still an oil painter, but I was pestering from years because we're friends. Like, dude, you need to try gouache. You just, as a study medium, it's just unparalleled because it does all these different things. He's like, yeah, I'll get to it. So I taught a class at his place and he participated and he took off with that medium. And it was so much fun to watch. I mean, he's like a sergeant of sorority. He's just that good. That he picked up the medium and within 30 minutes he was doing stuff. I couldn't figure out what he was doing.
Yeah. He did a demo on Plein Air Live in gouache and just blew everybody out of the water. And he said, you know, I'm just kind of figuring this out. And everybody's drooling over the beautiful work that he did.
Yeah. I mean, you know, for about 10 minutes I thought, well, I had something over Scott, and then he just blew me out of the water because he's that good. You know, and what I love about him, of course, is he's so friggin' humble about what he does. Yeah. That he doesn't see it, but
world's greatest guy.
He is. And so to watch someone switch mediums and all of a sudden a light goes on for him and he's accessing new ideas within the framework of what he already does. He's not going to become anything other than what he's been all his life, which is this amazing Western landscape painter. But he's accessed a new way of thinking about of layering color, of building color, of color relationships, of painting with something that doesn't quite go where you think it's going to go, and letting go of the outcome, and watching him explode, because you know he's very compulsive in a good way about doing anything. You know, he didn't do five; he did 1,000, as he is designed to do.
You know? That's he's obsessive about that, which is a really good thing.
Yeah.
Well, you know, but Rose Franson is very much the same way. She will try anything. I mean, or Charlie Hunter, you know, you throw a toothbrush at him and he'll figure out how to paint with it. And just because he's looking for new and interesting ways to approach things.
Yeah, and it shows in the work. I mean, you know, I love Charlie, and I've loved watching him evolve. The other great thing about social media is we're living in a retrospective book of everyone's work,
right.
And you can watch them grow over the years in real time and make these decisions. And it's a slow burn process to watch them change and grow. And I love that. It's so enjoyable for me. One of the upsides of social media. But
Well, and you know, one of the downsides or upsides is you never know who's watching.
Of course. What they, you know, and then the other downside is you get to hear what's in everyone's head, and that can apply to, you know, if you show a painting and you get kind of a negative response or everybody's quiet, you know, you don't get as many likes, whatever, and then you're going, then you start doubting, you know, is that the wrong thing? I let go of that stuff a long time ago, and I don't care. And
what goes through your head when you're painting? Because I think, you know, oftentimes I'm going through, you know, I'm painting something and I'm like, wow, they're really going to like this, you know, whoever they is. And, you know, then I find that when I do that, though, I'm painting for somebody else, not for myself. What goes through your head?
Well, fortunately, I've been doing this long enough that, the mental switch that I was talking about flipping, I just realized a while back that I wasn't being true to myself fully. I was being an artist and I was painting and doing a lot of plein air events, and which I love. I adore them and I learned so much and I made so many great friends. But at some point I just realized, like, I don't think I'm being true to myself. I really want to do something different. And I had to go on the hunt, the search for what worked for me. And so one of the things that I teach and I practice is to develop intent in the work. So what goes through my head in the beginning of every painting and throughout every mark and stroke is this intent, this idea of what I'm after. And I start off every painting, even if it's a plein air study in gouache or oil or whatever, I come at it with a very specific idea, and that thing keeps me focused. And I have like these three or four different lines of work that I'm doing now, and I know that there's an idea out there that you should do one thing and just do that. And I agree, that's probably true for certain gallery settings, or if you want to get known,
you get bored.
I can't do it. I can't do it, and I've come to terms with the fact that I enjoy chasing down ideas. And so every painting for me is a new idea, which is, it helps me to evolve quickly. And I rationalize it by just breaking it into two or three different completely different lines of work. And, it's just me. It's who I am. And I also give, I think in some way, hopefully give people permission to play their own themselves. And I hope in a way that's my identity, because that's who I am. And I guess part of my brand, if you will, you know.
Well, and I think your brand is at a different stage at different times. And so your brand is, you're Larry Moore, you're a creative guy, and you're going to experiment. But, you know, when you were starting out and trying to get into galleries or maybe in galleries, you probably had to be a little bit more consistent.
So, of course,
you might have to, you know, sometimes you paint for the gallery then you paint the other stuff because you want to do that on your own. Because if you confuse the marketplace in the beginning, once you're at a level of a Larry Moore or a Scott Christensen or a C.W. Mundy or somebody, then you can do whatever the heck you want to do, and everybody's going to accept it at that point. And by the way, if it doesn't sell, you probably don't care at that point.
Yeah. And I think I'm glad you're keeping me grounded here with this conversation, because the truth is, if you do want to get started in the commercial realm, which is both a plus and a minus in many ways, you do have to kind of toe the line and develop an identity, because that's what people want. And I kind of went through that process. And I think I'm on the other side of that. And now I'm developing different identities. I'm realizing that I have several and I'm chasing them down. And that is who I am. But you're absolutely right. And it's good to stay in an idea, to a line of thought or an intent. A great example of that would be Mark Hansen, you know, who's just keeps getting better. Every time I see other paintings, I'm like, dude, you can't get any better. And then you post a new painting. I'm like, okay, I don't know how you're doing it. But that's because he's staying in this intent of being a plein air painter. And he may switch mediums, oil and acrylic. You can't tell, you know, he's that good. And but to stay in an idea and chase it down until you're done, whenever that is. It could be a lifetime. It could be a couple of months and you go, okay, I'm bored. And then you try something different. And usually when people get stuck, it's just because they're bored with their line of thought. And they'll come and take my class to get unstuck. And the fun thing is, and this is what I know, like people are kind of like rubber bands. I stretch them way out. Like I push them way out of their comfort zone to try different things. And they don't break. They don't change who they are. They'll take the information that they've acquired in a class and they'll feed it back into the work with a brand new excitement for what they're doing. And then they're happy again for years because they've learned how to bust out of the being stuck in doing the same thing over and over again. I become kind of a student of the human condition, almost a therapist. You know, I should probably get a license for that because that's a big part of this process is understanding how people work.
Do you want to ask me any deep questions?
Me? No. How does that make you, feel, Eric?
It makes me nervous, Larry.
Well, let's talk about that. Let's talk about that, Eric. I think that's important. No, I like, you know, the great thing about you and your head has got to be just packed with that. You can't possibly have any more room in your head for information with all the people that you talk to, you know? And so you're just a wealth source of info and it's got to be fun for you.
Well, it is fun, but it's also confusing as heck. You know, I told somebody the other day, I said, you know, I was going to all the video shoots. You know, we do 30, 40 video shoots a month with some of the best artists in the world. And then I hang out with them for dinner and, you know, sometimes we go painting together. And for the longest time, it was like, oh, I'm going to add that color to my palette or I'm going to try this.
Right.
And it's kind of like when you're out painting with other people and you start looking at their work and you're thinking, oh, they did that mountain better than I did, or they put that tree in. And so you start changing to what they think. And it was driving me nuts. And I finally had to say, you know, I'm not going to go to the shoots anymore. I'll watch the videos, but I am not going to, and I'll pick up a tip here and there, but I had to kind of stabilize because otherwise, you know, you just,
yeah, too much information can really confound you. That's true. That is absolutely true. Until you start to learn how to separate it and compartmentalize and find the things that are important to you. And that's the process of discovering who you are too, is to seek out, you know, we go to workshops, maybe initially I did, to go, I want to paint like that person and I want to learn their tricks. And then at some point you realize I'm not that person. I can't be that person, but I can take some of their ideas and adapt them into my work. And that's the place, that's the headspace that we want to be in. You know, if I took a Daniel Sprick class, I could work with a guy for a year, 10 years, I don't know. I'd never be Daniel Sprick. He is otherworldly, but I don't want to be Daniel Sprick. You know, I want to be me. And so I might take the way he thinks about shapes or the way he goes from out of focus to in focus in his work and apply it to my methodology and give it a run. You know, and see how it works for a while.
Well, even the best of the best have figured out that there's somebody who can teach them something. I think it was Tim Lawson I was talking to, and he said, you know, I don't remember who he mentioned. Maybe it was Matt Smith or something. He said, you know, whoever it was, he said, they do great clouds. They do clouds better than anybody else, and I can't figure out how to do it. So I went and took a workshop with him. And so I think, you know, we look at the areas that we want to improve, and we say, who's good at it, and we go for it.
Yeah, which, you know, takes me to this other place, and I'll go back to Scott Christensen. So he and I have a great friendship, and one of the things that we often do, like on an annual basis, we just get together and we talk about art for a week, and it's all, you know, we just talk about art and maybe some relationships and stuff like that, food occasionally, but mostly art, you know, and because to be good, to be creative requires an intensely a curious mind. All the greats are intensely curious. And they're also, I think, open to receiving information from other sources. The really good ones are. And those are the ones that it's not going to change. If I took a workshop with anybody, it's not going to make me them. I'm going to absorb some of the information into my own and adapt it into my own. Our job is to observe, absorb and adapt, and with emphasis on that last word is to adapt, because otherwise we become clones of somebody else, and that's not fun.
Well, it depends on who you're being a clone of, I suppose.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, there's a couple of people I wouldn't mind being, you know, but
Elon Musk.
Yeah. Oh, I love that guy because he's a thinker. I mean, he's a little kooky, but he's an idea person, and I love idea. I love artists. I'm a student of the arts in that I love all methods. I love architecture. I love installation work. I love abstract art. I love great representational art, as long as it's good, and you can spot the not so good right off the bat once you know what you're looking for.
What I learned from Musk is that he lays it all on the line every time. In other words, you know, he's worth billions of dollars, but if he screws up, he loses all of it because he's put it all on the line.
You know, he's a risk taker.
He's not sitting there accumulating. And I think being a risk taker is so important as a painter.
It's important as a human being, as a productive member of society, to take chances to better, hopefully, the world that you live in and the world that you personally are in. And that requires taking risks. And my whole class is designed on that premise, is the only growth lives in the uncomfortable places. That's where growth lives. You can learn to master a skill set by repeating it over and over again, but which is good. But beyond that, that's as far as you go. So being curious and being open to new information and be willing to put yourself into the place of being uncomfortable, which, again, I'll go back to martial arts. For me, I'm uncomfortable every time I go into a class because the master's always teaching us something new or something that I've forgotten. And I'm uncomfortable because I don't know how to do it. But at the same time, I go, that's okay, because I'm learning and I'm folding something new into my repertoire. So that's the headspace I'm always in.
And that goes back to that beginner painter, and that is embrace the pain. You know, don't give up when you get the pain.
Don't give up.
Just embrace it. And know you're going to have more pain and you're going to be uncomfortable. And if you're uncomfortable, you're in a good place.
Yes. Life is pain, which is from Princess Bride, by the way.
Speaking of pain, we're kind of out of time now. So
no way.
Yeah.
Was that an hour?
Yeah.
Holy cow.
Yeah,
but that was so fast.
But we'll do another hour, and not today, but we have so much more to talk about. Where do people find out about these classes and workshops that you're doing?
Oh, the best place is my website, of course, LarryMoreStudios.com, and just click on workshops. I haven't posted what's coming up in the next year, but I'm always posting, and you can always email me, and I'll put you on the list, or follow me on Facebook. I don't post any of that stuff on Instagram. I could be a better marketer about it, but I'm kind of busy, you know. So, yeah, just my website is a perfectly good place to look. You can, if you're interested more in information on the book that I've written, Fishing for Elephants, there's a link to that on my book. It insights and exercises I can't remember how it goes, but it's to promote authentic creativity in the individual, which has become my reason, my purpose, and my cause is to help people with that.
Oh, it's a highly recommended book too. So everybody needs to get that right now, just right now.
Yes. Do what Eric says. It's good for you.
Well, it really is. I wouldn't say it if I didn't believe it. Larry, this has been challenging, delightful.
Always a joy.
Brain stimulation. And most of all, it's a happy place. So thank you so much.
Yeah. I look forward to a time when you and I can just sit down and just talk about anything.
All right.
That's always good.
Let's do it. You and I and Scott will go spend 10 days talking about art.
That's fine by me.
Preferably in Russia.
Okay. I've not been. It's on my list.
All right.
All right.
Thank you, Larry.
Absolutely. Talk soon, Eric.
Man, I can't wait till part two. We'll have to find another time to get an interview with Larry Moore. That was just fabulous. Hope you enjoyed it. You guys ready for some marketing ideas?
This is the Marketing Minute with Eric Rhoads, author of the number one Amazon bestseller, Make More Money Selling Your Art, Proven Techniques to Turn Your Passion into Profit.
In the Marketing Minute, I try to answer your art marketing questions. Email yours to me, eric@artmarketing.com. By the way, that's a great resource with lots of marketing articles I've written, artmarketing.com. Here's a question from Michael D. in Buffalo, New York, who says, I've heard that my website should be mobile optimized. What on earth does that mean? Well, think of it this way, Michael. Most of us have smartphones now. Not everybody does, but most of us use our smartphones for everything. And the research indicates now that most of Google visits are on a smartphone and that most website visits are on a smartphone. It's like 80 or 90%. That's how high it is. And if a website is designed for a big screen or a computer screen, then things sometimes you have to scroll side to side to see them or things get cut off. And so what you want to do is have a mobile optimized website, meaning it stacks things so that you can kind of scroll through them and the columns are narrower and the type is fit for mobile. Because some of us have little tiny type and can't read it in mobile, but it looks okay on a big screen computer or something like that. So basically, you want to get it mobile optimized. Now, what most of the website providers do is they have a mobile optimization tag where you can essentially go in there and look at how your website's going to look on mobile, and you can usually design your website so it looks better on mobile. And then it will choose. So, for instance, it'll pick the mobile site for those who are on mobile, and it'll pick the other site for those on the web. And that way, it's optimized for each of those, because you don't want a mobile-optimized site on your main site, usually. But this way, you have something that works in both worlds. Now, if you use an art website provider, most of those people know how to do that and can do that for you. But not all of them, and so you'll have to check into that. But being mobile-optimized is important, and I think from a marketing standpoint, too, if you're marketing something, you want to be thinking about being mobile optimized, because if you're sending out emails or newsletters to people and your columns are too wide, then you're just going to make people frustrated. There's nothing more frustrating for me than getting an email and I have to scroll side to side to see the photo or see something. It just isn't a very comfortable experience. So anyway, I hope that helps. The next question comes from Deborah M. in Louisville, Kentucky. That's the proper way to say it. Louisville, not Louisville, not Louisville, Louisville. All right. I learned that because I live near there. Now, somebody will call me and say, no, it's not Louisville. Anyway, Deborah says, I know you're big on using Instagram, and I just started my art Instagram page, but since I'm new, how do I get followers on it? Boy, that's a loaded question. You know, a lot of people have moved over to Instagram from Facebook, and some are doing both. A lot of us kind of like Instagram because there's not as much negativity in politics there and so on. But anyway, Instagram is a beautiful thing and it's a beautiful place and it's a good potential marketing tool. The one thing you want to start thinking about if you're designing from scratch, you want to ask yourself, who is my audience? Who am I speaking to? Am I speaking to fellow artists? Am I speaking to art collectors, people who just love art? Do I care? The only reason you should care is if you're going to use it as a marketing tool, because if it's a marketing tool, then you have to know your audience, right? So your audience, if you're marketing, let's say you're an artist and you're teaching workshops and you want people to hear about your workshops, then your Instagram page needs to be a little bit geared towards that. If it's about art collecting and buying paintings, then that's a different way of approaching things. But Instagram, I am studying it like crazy, trying to learn as much as I possibly can. I've just been through a big course, a very expensive course, and I'm going through another very expensive course because things are changing all the time, and I'm watching these things all the time. Essentially, and by the way, I have a lot of people helping me with Instagram too, and I'm still learning. So essentially what you want to do is know your audience and then know what they want. Your job in Instagram is to tell stories, visual stories. So you want to look for ways that you can have high quality content that tells stories. Now, people love to see experiences on Instagram. So if you're out painting, for instance, then look for ways to share experiences on your Instagram. Look for different ways to post. Now, if you really are serious about it, you're going to be posting in a lot of different ways. And this doesn't seem like this is how you grow it, but this is how you grow it. You grow it through good content. Content is everything in Instagram. So you want to have a good post. There's also a thing called Instagram stories, which appear at the top of the page. And if you post a lot and you post and people follow you, you're going to end up showing up on everybody's screen the first time they open up. And that's a beautiful thing. So you want to start posting stories on Instagram. Again, you want your stories to relate to what it is you're trying to communicate. And then there's a thing called Reels, which is a very small, I think under 30 seconds or under a minute. I'm not sure exactly what it is. And that the Reels are videos. And so Instagram is trying to get Reels off the ground because they want to compete with TikTok. And as a result, they're putting a lot of favor to that. So if you have Reels, they're going to push it out and let people see it more frequently. And when people see things that they push out, they're going to come to you and they're going to say, oh, this person's interesting. I'm going to follow them. So now there's a lot of other things you can do. For instance, you can go on your Facebook and say, hey, everybody that follows me, will you follow me on Instagram and give a link? You can also do promotions. You know, one thing that's very popular is to do a giveaway where it says, you know, I'm going to give away, let's say I'll use a painting, for instance. I'm going to give away this painting. You've got 30 days to enter or 10 days to enter. And the way to enter is, number one, is you have to follow this account. And then you put your Instagram thing there. And number two is you have to hit the like button. That shows interactivity. Number three is you have to leave a comment. And by doing those three things, it helps other people discover you through other people. And then you want to make sure that you have a hashtag in there that says something like giveaways or Instagram giveaways or giveaways online or something. Look for the Instagrams that are hot. And then there are a lot of people who will follow you just from a giveaway. Now, the downside of that is you're going to get followers who are not necessarily buyers, and they might not even care about you. They're just following you for your giveaway. But if your giveaway is relevant to something that they like and care about, that'll make a big difference. Now, the other thing that I think is important is Instagram, you don't want to be posting all the time. You want to do one, maybe two posts a day, and you want to do it consistently 7 days a week. Now, you can get schedulers. There's software that you can get. You just get, you know, look up, Google it, and there's lots of different companies that make it. And that way you can kind of put all your posts together, take a couple hours in one day a week and put all your posts together and do that. The things that don't work is, you know, all this random stuff that has nothing to do with what you want to be known for. You're going to want to get to the point where you have, if people look at the 17 or 18 icons that are showing on your webpage or on your Instagram page, you want them to be, and you can arrange those, by the way, and make sure that they're the best ones. You want them to be things that are about what the web page is about. You know, we've learned that if let's say you're doing a painting about, let's say watercolor. And if you post all watercolor stuff, then you're cool. But the minute you post something that's not watercolor, maybe it's a picture of your food, you'll lose a lot of people just from that one post. And so you want to be consistent about what you post, unless, of course, you're trying to sell your person, your personality. And, you know, I post things about my family and about things where I am, along with a lot of the other stuff. Some people don't like it and they'll unfollow. But, you know, I'm also trying to communicate that, you know, I'm just a family guy that just happens to love art. And so anyway, hope you'll follow me on Instagram at Eric Rhoads and on Facebook and other such things. Anyway, this, I hope, has been helpful. This has been the Marketing Minute.
This has been the Marketing Minute with Eric Rhoads. You can learn more at artmarketing.com.
Thank you very much. A couple of reminders. Don't forget to join us at Pastel Live. There's still time. Just go to pastellive.com. You don't want to miss it. Also, check out Fall Color Week. It's a chance to paint together in the fall color of upstate New York. It's beautiful. PaintRussia.com if you want to go with me to Russia. And don't miss Bill Davidson's video workshop, Painting with Energy. You're going to love it. It's at streamline.art. And if you've not seen my weekly blog where I talk about life and things and stuff and family and all kinds of things, it's called Sunday Coffee, and you can find it at coffeewitheric.com. And then go in there and subscribe. It'll come to you every week. I'm Eric Rhoads, the publisher and founder of Plein Air magazine. There are Plein Air people all over the world. I hope you'll join the movement. We love you guys. We love Plein Air painting. You can find us online at outdoorpainter.com. And remember, it is a big world. Go paint it. We'll see you soon. Bye-bye.
This has been the Plein Air Podcast with Plein Air Magazine's Eric Rhoads. You can help spread the word about Plein Air painting by sharing this podcast with your friends. And you can leave a review or subscribe on iTunes so it comes to you every week. And you can even reach Eric by email, eric@pleinairmagazine.com. Be sure to pick up our free ebook, 240 Plein Air Painting Tips by Some of America's Top Painters. It's free at pleinairtips.com. Tune in next week for more great interviews. Thanks for listening.